Welcome. I'm Jeffrey Snover, distinguished engineer and lead architect for Windows Server, and I'm joined today by...
I'm Erin Chappell. I'm the group program manager for the core management experience in Windows Server.
And we are crazy excited to talk to you today about multi-machine capabilities of Windows Server 2012. It's a really exciting release, and we're just honored to be able to be the ones to show you some of this great stuff.
And so, if you see something you like, don't be afraid to make some noise. It'll be great feedback. We have a bunch of members of the team that are in the audience, and I'm sure they'd love to hear the things that you think are just really exciting in this release.
Yeah. So I want to start with some context, right? Provide you some background as to what it is we're doing and why we're doing it, right? Windows Server's always been a great operating system for a server and its devices. But starting with Windows Server 2012, there's a transformation. And the transformation is that now we want to be a great server for lots of servers, a great OS for lots of servers, for the devices connecting them, whether they're physical, virtual, on-premises, or off-premises. So indeed, we want to be a cloud-optimized or a cloud OS. And this is a fundamental change in the responsibilities of the operating system. So it's really quite exciting. Now, in order to do that, we have to change the things that we're doing. A lot of things that we do for a single server, we've got to rethink and reimagine in the context of lots of machines, okay? And so these fall down into the areas of standards-based management, robust automation, and multi-machine management, okay? So let's drill into those. Standards-based management.
Perfect. So we're going to spend a little bit of time in each of these areas and talk through just the context of where we see the world today and what was influenced our design and how we approached Windows Server 2012. So let's start out with standards-based management, which is really kind of the foundation of our overall management experience. So when we look at the ecosystem today, there's a challenge that exists for us. When you start to look at just the number of resources out there that you need to manage, there's your disk, there's storage, there's Exchange, there's devices, various managed objects. Each of those provide today typically a management experience that's unique to that resource, right?
They're talking in the back.
Oh,
just keep going.
Sorry, we have a little noise behind the stage. We'll try and ignore that.
Crosstalk.
So from a disk, so when you think about that, it becomes really difficult for the different people who have to interact with that system, whether or not you be an IT pro or a developer that's writing applications that manage the environment, to really understand and consume that information, because it's very different. Today, if you go and you manage or think about managing SQL, you learn a different set of concepts than if you go manage storage. And so when we think about this and we think about the move towards standards-based management, we really want to provide a layer of abstraction, right, which we call WMF, or the Windows Management Framework. And the Windows Management Framework is our management platform that allows people who are providing artifacts to manage their resources to expose it in a standard way so that they can be consumed by IT professionals or developers in that standards-based way.
By the way, this is one of the definitions of architecture. Architecture is a design that transforms an N by N problem into an N by one problem. And that's what we're doing here.
And if we double click into the Windows Management Framework, we really are basing that around standards, industry standards. You know, if we just created and solved that architectural problem in a way where we provided you with a proprietary way to expose and consume management objects, that really wouldn't help. Right? Because it would be Windows specific. And we know that we live in an ecosystem where there are Windows and non-Windows devices. So within the Windows Management Framework, we really have three layers of investment. The first layer of investment is around the standard model. Right? And this is based on SIM, the Common Information Model, which is an industry standard in terms of how you describe or expose the management object. We then have a standard way in which you can actually connect to and interact with the managed endpoint through Windows AWS Management, REST, HTTP, or the PowerShell remoting protocol. And then we expose that through a set of standard APIs. In this release, we've made significant investments in our managed client, providing a standard API. We have PowerShell, and new to this release, we're actually exposing through OData the PowerShell information that we deliver within the box. So what are the specific investments that we've made in Windows 2012? I think I owe a dollar because there's actually a Windows 8 up there, and it's our old reference from our old slide deck.
No, we do this on the client as well.
Oh, yeah, that's true. That's true. So what have we done in this release specifically around the standards-based infrastructure? First, we've made it much, much easier for people to actually instrument their services in Windows. Those of you, I don't know how many in the audience have tried creating a WMI provider in the past, but that's a very taxing, very long experience. And in this release, that's become much simpler. In fact, the networking team has actually exposed the surface of networking through WMI in this release. And they first came to us and said, do you really want us to do this? And then when they looked at the new API and how to do that, they're like, oh, this is much, much simpler. And once you expose your artifacts through or the system through WMI, you then get PowerShell essentially for free.
Yeah, I think they said that it was an order of magnitude easier to write a WMI V2 provider than the original provider.
The original one.
Yeah.
And then they got all of this PowerShell commandlets essentially for free, because you can essentially create a little metadata file on top of your WMI provider that gives you all the PowerShell syntax and makes that exposed, so it's available to the PowerShell ecosystem of people who are familiar with PowerShell. And then we've also allowed you to build applications using REST and OData. We have a new PowerShell web service that allows you to actually interact and get information from the system using OData. So that's kind of how we've simplified just creating the artifacts within Windows. What that allows us to do, because it's based on standards, because it's WMI, that allows us to manage non-Windows devices from Windows, because we have a set of built-in SIM classes and SIM commandlets that allow you to connect to any device that supports SIM. And it also allows you to manage Windows from non-Windows devices. So from a Linux machine, you can actually connect to, using SIM, a Windows machine, and use all of the built-in SIM providers. And actually, Jeffrey's going to demo that in just a little bit. So simplified the cost of developing our WMI providers, exposing that through PowerShell. That gives us a much richer ecosystem in terms of what we can manage. And then we've done a couple of other things. One, we've enabled WSMAN by default on all servers.
Ooh.
So what that means is we really think that moving forward that the server core should be the default configuration. And we don't want you to have to actually go to that machine and perform some configuration. We want you to be able to remotely manage that just out of the box. So WSMAN is enabled by default, which allows remoting, so you can connect to and finish your configuration of your server core machines.
What that means is, for all you people who've been arguing with your security people that it was safe and okay to install WSMAN on by default, now you won.
And then we've also and then we've also made significant investments in the area of storage by providing an SMIS service in the box that's actually leveraged by the storage solution. And there are a number of talks that go through specifically what we're doing in the storage space here. But we have an SMIS service in the box that can discover SMIS-based storage and then expose that to the operating system to be consumed in a standards way. Now, you might be saying, this is all great, but do I have to go to Windows Server 2012 for this? No, you don't. We've actually provide the WMF, or the Windows Management Framework 3.0. That's the new version of that. And it actually ships down level. So it goes down to Windows Server 2008, 2008 R2, as well as Windows 7. And there's actually a release preview, release candidate of that that's available right now. So you can go out and download that and use it in your existing environment, try it out, and try many of the new features that we're going to walk through today.
And if you have the older version, PowerShell version 2, on your older versions of the OS, XP and above, it interoperates with this. So XP will be able to manage Windows Server 2012. Windows Server 2012 will be able to manage XP.
Perfect. So with that, I'm going to hand it to you, Jeffrey, to walk us through our first demo.
All right. Standards-based management. Nope, this one. I'll start here and then I'm going to
hit
that one.
Oh, OK. All right.
Yeah, get ready, man. OK. So first, I'm going to show you some of the new commandlets that we have for standards-based management. So we have a new module, sim commandlets, and here are all the new sim commandlets. Now these are different than the WMI commandlets in that we've updated WMI to be the latest standards, and there have been some changes. And in particular, these sim commandlets go over WSMAN. So a bunch of the things that I'm showing you here will work against heterogeneous machines, raw hardware, Linux boxes, routers, et cetera. Okay, so here are the commandlets. Now we've got discovery, so I can say git sim class, show me all the things that have a disk in it, all the classes. Okay, so you can see that. Oh, it's firing up some stuff. One of the other nice things you can do is now you can say, well, find me all the classes that have a method name that have of a particular type, or a particular name. So we're here, we're finding all the classes that have a method name starting with term or terminate. You can also find the classes by the property name. Find me all the classes that have a handle property, right? Or find me those things that have a qualifier name of association. So pretty rich stuff. Nicer, you know, one of the problems in the past with these standards is they're great, but then how do you find the stuff? There's so much there. And you'll find that these discovery utilities help enormously, okay? So now I'm going to go get a couple couple variables. I'm going to get the processes. And notice we have now sim class. Okay, let's do it this way. X.sim class. I'm showing off some of the, I wanted to do it this way to show you off some of the cool things we've added to PowerShell ISE. So we've got IntelliSense here. And notice I say .sim class. Okay, and so from the object itself, you can get the class information. That's a big change. And then $y, $y pipe two, I'm gonna do a for each, two string. And notice we now have a default two string for each one of the sim objects that is very nice. It's very easy to understand exactly what it is. In the past, this could be pretty opaque. So it's much easier to work with. Okay, here you can get information from remote machines. So I'm going to get sim instance of computer system, and I get it from three machines, which is all basically myself here. But you can just say minus computer name to get it from remote machines, or you can issue create a session. Okay, so we've got new session, get session, remove session, and this establishes all the connection information, and then you can use that over and over again. Okay, so we'll create a session to these three machines. We'll show the three machines, the session for those. Oh, sorry. We'll show the session for those. Okay, those are the session. Notice it says protocol WSMAN, right? You could have set up a session to use WSMAN, the default, or DCOM if you want to go against a down-level Windows machine. And then you can go ahead and get things using the session instead of the computer name. Okay, and so that simplifies things. So here's how you do this, working with these commands if you want to go to a down-level Windows machine that can only talk DCOM. So you set a session option, protocol DCOM, and then when you create that sim session, you specify that. You specify those options, and now look, when I specify this, oh, I did it wrong. Now you see that its protocol is DCOM, okay? And so then we can use DCOM as well. So WSMAN, you've got a new set of commandlets, work with the standards-based stuff, but still have backward compatibility to some of your down-level Windows machines. So here, I just wanted to show you some of the things that you can do, show off some of the new PowerShell stuff. This is a workflow to get inventory information. And here what I'm showing you is you've got a set of classes, Win32 operating system, Win32 processor, disk drive, et cetera, and we've got this for each parallel, and I say for each parallel for each one of the classes get sim instance. And so this is a technique that you can use to do massive, you know, your inventory against a large number of machines, against a large number of classes in a very high throughput way. So I encourage you to go explore with that stuff. Now with that, put your seatbelt on. We're going to have some fun. Okay. Here's my guy. Okay. So this, look at it, the glorious Windows Server 2012. Now notice what it's showing you is, you know, it's an all-up information, and it's showing you what things are installed. So you see I've got just file and storage services for now, okay? Okay, so why is that interesting? Well, let's go ahead and install some roles on this machine. So here, what is the state of this machine? Oh, there you go. Notice that's a different screenshot. This is, in fact, this is Fedora. This is Linux. Okay, so what's the point of the standards-based management? Standards-based management is it means you can have interoperability. So I'm going to go show you how you do things from Linux. So here I've got a thing, a commandlet, Python, and I'm going to go against that remote Windows server, and I'm going to say, get me the roles. So now we use standards-based management, WSMAN and SIM, to go get the roles from a Windows server and showing you that on a Linux machine. Is that crazy or what? Okay. But wait, it gets better. This is crazy stuff. I just can't contain my excitement. Okay, so remember we said, oh, look, it's a new world, right? Cloud OS, we deal with lots of things, whether they're physical or virtual. So here I'm showing you the information about the what's physically installed, what's installed in that physical machine. But also on that server, I've got a VHD. Okay, so let's see what's installed on the VHD. That's right, let's hear it again. From a Linux machine, I want to see what Windows Server roles are installed on a VHD. And the way you do that is here. Now this takes a bit of time because we've got to mount the VHD, and so you'll see in a second some progress indications. See that progress, 5%. So what we're doing again, standards-based management, going to a Windows server, talking to the VHD on that Windows server, getting into the Windows server roles, and there you have it. Is that crazy or what? Woo, I love it. But wait, it gets better. So now, instead of just doing a get, I'm gonna do an install. And now we've hardwired this script to install the fax server. Now the interesting thing is I'm installing the fax server. Let's see. Yay. And if I went to do this again, we'd see that the get the fax server, but actually what I want to do is I'll show it to you this way. Now we'll do a refresh cycle here. And we not only installed the fax server, but it also installed the print and document server, which is a prerequisite of the fax server. So this is standards-based management made real. Pretty exciting stuff.
Awesome. Thanks, Jeffrey. So as this is an overview session, we have several other presentations over the course of the next few days that will take the things that we're kind of teasing for you and dive into them in deeper details. So this afternoon, there's a session around standard support and interoperability that'll go into much more detail than we've been able to do here in the 15 minutes that we had. So I encourage you, if this is an area that's important to you, to go check out that session. So let's move on to our second major area of investment around robust automation. So when we take a look at, again, the landscape, the ecosystem, what's happening, we see an increasing need for robust automation. And this is largely due to the fact that it's a fact that the world is intrinsically messy. Right? Although we might prefer a world that is a little more clean, and I think we're driving towards some of that through our investments in standards-based management, it just takes a while for the ecosystem to adopt these standards-based. And as that's happening, innovation keeps moving forward. And so this results in a world where you have inconsistency across systems, you're managing different systems in different states. There's reliability issues, you know, as we think about kind of network flakiness and as we move into the cloud, the ability to access things in large scale across large geodistributions. And really just managing that scale is challenging, right? So we really see this need for robust automation to help tailor solutions in your environment that meet your needs. to help actually customize and build tools that take care of the environment that you live in and help you drive towards a more standardized environment or standardized way of doing things. Really, automation is the way that I think we introduce reliability and consistency, uptime in the system, because you have a repeatable way of being able to perform the tasks, whether or not they be formal kind of tasks that you do on a regular basis or ad hoc management, those one-off tasks that you need to do, where you're going to want to have automation to really help you do that in a reliable way. And so our investments in PowerShell have really put us on this journey. Right, we released PowerShell 1.0 two operating system versions ago, and PowerShell 1.0 was kind of our dipping our toe into the water of this world of robust automation. It provided a limited set of commandlets. It allowed you to do mostly things on the local machine, but allowed some remote management through WMI objects, and provided the startings of an extensibility framework where people could start to build their own commandlets in that environment. With PowerShell 2.0, we made a huge investment around remoting. Really, that ability to manage, you know, one to many or many to one was a significant investment. And we started to see that other teams like Exchange, Active Directory, started to actually produce commandlets to increase the surface area of what you could automate through both the operating system but also the server apps that ran on top of it. And we started to tease and put in some things around managing schedule jobs and things that started to get into that world of how you really want to live in and deal with that messy environment. In this release, we've made a significant number of investments. And the next slide will actually show you the list of features we've added, which is a bit of an eye chart. But we really categorize these investments into four main areas. First, we've heard the feedback that the learning curve around PowerShell can be a little steep. Right? And as people start and are familiar with their GUI tools and they want to start to move towards this world of robust automation, that can be a pretty big step to get over. And so we've made a significant number of investments in just making PowerShell simple and easy to learn. Jeffrey's going to demo a whole bunch of this, so I'm not going to go into details. But please check out the new integrated scripting ISE, because it's added IntelliSense and simplified syntax, and that's just really, we think, is going to help people onboard.
We know it's going to help.
From a coverage standpoint, I don't know if those of you who were early in the audience, you actually saw Jeffrey do a little search and replace in the deck. We actually now have over 2,400 new commandlets that are shipping in the box with Windows Server 2012. And really, at this point in time, we think that your ability to automate from an end-to-end scenario standpoint, the things that we ship with Windows, is very high. And I think that Jeffrey will show some of the commandlets that we've added.
Yeah, indeed. This is, you know, honestly, when it comes to simplicity, coverage was always going to be the key, right? Because we wanted to create a world where you think, you type, and you get. And in version 1 and version 2, you could do that for a certain set of things, but then you ended up having to do scripting way too much, and now you don't have to. So,
as I talked about, we really know that the world is intrinsically messy, and so we've added a bunch of functionality around robust connections to deal with that network flakiness. We've added workflow for you to be able to actually have long-running scripts, the ability to connect, to remote connect and disconnect, so if something happens, you can start something on a remote machine, disconnect from it, reconnect to it at a later time. So just a bunch of things that help you deal with the world that we know you live in. And then lastly, V3 is a better
Don't
V2.
Don't forget scheduled jobs.
Oh, scheduled, go for it.
Travis is in the room, man. Can't forget scheduled jobs. Scheduled jobs are we've integrated with the task scheduler. And so we have this nice way to be able to manage task scheduler and a simplified syntax so that you can run scripts at, run this script every time the system reboots, every Friday at 5 o'clock, whenever some event happens. So it makes things a ton easier.
And then lastly, V3 is just a better V2. I think we've been, if those of you in the room who interact with PowerShell may be familiar with the Connect site, but that's the way in which we get feedback from you. And we take that feedback very seriously. There have been over 150 bugs that we fixed that have come directly from the community. Some of those are bugs, some of those are actually feature suggestions. Actually, it's now 200, Travis is signaling to me. And then we made a bunch of investments in the underlying engine and the infrastructure to get better performance, better scalability, to have tab completion and hidden directories, just lots of things that really increase the robustness of that underlying platform. So let me stop talking and let's get, here was our eye chart of the PowerShell features that have actually been added in. And all these decks are live, so you can take a look at that after and, you know, pick a new feature, I think maybe one for every day of the next year and get to know. But significant investment in PowerShell. So with that, I'm going to hand it off to Jeffrey, and Jeffrey's going to walk you through the things we've done to help simplify and make it easy to automate your environment.
Excellent. So here is the list of the modules that we've added, or that there now exists on the system. You get Active Directory, BitLocker, DNS, iSCSI, a lot of networking, storage. There's just a ton of stuff there. As I say, over 2,400 commandlets. So, you know, go explore. It's a great world. Now, again, we tried to create this world where you can just think about what you want, you can type it, and you can get it. So let's explore. Imagine you wanted to get, you know, create a new SMB share. How would you do that? Well, in the past, this was how you did it. Okay, this is a VB script. Right? And you have the folder name and you get WMI with some very sexy looking syntax there, like that. And then, don't forget this array. I mean, that's pretty logical. You were probably thinking that, right? Anyway, it just goes on and on and on, and that's how you used to create an SMB share in the past. Well, I think you might agree there's some opportunity to improve that experience. So here, I mean, so what is it that you were thinking? You wanted to create a new SMB share. Oh, yeah. What did you want to do? Well, you wanted to have its name be temp and its path be C:temp. Yeah? And maybe give full access to ntdev.jsnover. Yeah, that's what I think I'd like to do. And voila, you get it. Okay? So this is, thank you. You know, great job by the storage team here. So again, lots of high-level task-oriented abstractions for you to now work with. I think you're gonna like that a lot. Okay, next, let's talk about simplification. So in the past, if you've ever seen a PowerShell demo, I guarantee, by the way, how many people use PowerShell? Okay, great.
Awesome.
By the way, so for those of you who are going to be new to the PowerShell community, the PowerShell team loves bug reports. We love criticism. It's nice to hear when you like things. I mean, that's useful. But honestly, it's not actionable. When you tell us about a problem you have, we get to fix it. So we love that stuff. So please engage and tell us about all the things that we're not doing as well as you'd like us to do. So one of the things you said was, boy, that syntax sometimes is kind of tough. So if you've ever seen a PowerShell demo, I guarantee you've seen this. Get process where dot. By the way, look at this. You now have IntelliSense in a pipeline. Where handle count, now look at this, for operators now. Yeah, give it up, man, that's great stuff. Greater than 900, okay? Okay, so that's great, okay? But that's still a bit kind of tough, right? That's syntax. So now we've got a simplified where, and you can just say that, okay? So see, this is much easier. Also, let's start a few things. Calc, calc, calc. Just can't get enough of that calculator. Now, I'm going to do a get process. And I used to say, well, I want the ID for each one of these things. And you used to have to do this. Geez, I'm not sure we should have done this. This is pretty easy now. Anyway, so, oops, get process, calc. And you get the ID for each of those. Well, now, you no longer have to do that either. Woo! And so you just get the IDs. And of course, we got the alias for each. percent time, if you can remember that. So it's very nice and simple, and we've eliminated a lot of the syntax. And if you want to, for each, you can kill them. Whack, it all went away. So that's a simplified where and for each. And of course, we're showing this all in the wonderful and glorious ISE, the integrated scripting environment. Really amazing stuff here, right? So get, process, you got IntelliSense, name, star SS, to where, dot, and look at that, we're smart. In this version, we use what's called the dynamic language runtime, which is basically a way of taking the program itself and analyzing it for tool generators. And so the IntelliSense takes advantage of what's called an abstract syntax tree, an AST, to do crazy powerful stuff. That's why we know when you do get process, it outputs process objects. And so we reflect against that and say, okay, well, here are the properties of the process object, and so it makes it available to you, right? Whatever, company name, et cetera. Now, let me give you an example of that to show you just how crazy powerful that stuff is. Now, notice, I've not set $X, right? $X does not exist. Let's make sure that's true. Oh, it does exist. So let's use $Q. Okay, $Q does not exist. And I'm going to do dir, right? I'm writing a script. Now, I have not run it, right? But here, notice it shows it analyzed the entire program, right? This next sign, this could have been separated by 100 lines of code. It goes back and sees, oh, you're acting upon Q. Where did Q get set in the program? Oh, what was the command that set it? What is the output type of that command? And so now it knows that I'm going to have file objects, so it gives me directory, full name, extension, et cetera. Okay? So that's just crazy powerful. But, put your seatbelt on. This is just freakish. HKLM. It knows that I'm going to do, there goes software. It knows that I'm going to do a directory of the registry. And so now when I do IntelliSense, I get subkey count. It's that smart. Is that crazy? So this IntelliSense, there's a lot to this IntelliSense. Now, one of the things I use occasionally is the PowerShell parser, right? But I can never remember where it is. Like, where the heck is that thing? And is it PS parser? I know it's kind of PS parser. Huh. And so if I tab, goes and finds it. Okay? So it finds the namespace. Oh, that was in system management automation. So it's a very rich and intelligent IntelliSense. Cool stuff. Okay, but again, 2,400 commandlets. Anybody see you talk yesterday with me and Don Jones? Yeah, great talk. Had a blast doing that. Don is trying to use this, and he kept saying, oh, darn those 2,400 commandlets, because now there are so many commandlets that finding them was a task. Well, now we have the show command, okay, the show window. And so this is an explorer window over here, and you're able to say, hey, I'd like to find all the things in the all the sim commandlets, and you can just see them, or you can ask for all the commandlets. Or go back to all. Yeah, and sim. Oh, no module name. I screwed that up. All. Hello, all. Okay, I get to file bug. Okay, so then you can find, well, hey, show me all the things with VHDs. Well, I don't have anything with SIM. Okay, and you can select this, and here you can fill out the names, the information, Win32 BIOS, and you can run it if you want, or you can insert it, right? And so there you can insert it into a command line or into a script. Let's see, did I have that right? Insert. Yeah. Okay. So very easy to go find stuff and interact with things and find all the information with this show command. Very cool stuff. Okay. Lots of features that you asked for. We have regions. And region. And notice that line that got set there. So now you can go whoop, whoop, whoop. So you got regions, very cool stuff. Lots of great stuff. And I don't know about you, but sometimes some of the syntax I have a hard time remembering, like the switch statement. For some reason, I always forget the switch statement and the help. For the life of me, I can never remember comment-based help, like synopsis and description and blah, blah, blah. I just can't remember it. So, Control-J, we have snippets. Okay, this is an extensible thing. You can add your own snippets. So here, I'm going to do a snippet for Commandlet. Okay, it gives all the documentation. Right, I just go in and replace things, sets things up. Here, it's a process loop. I'm going to go replace this with a switch, with a syntax for a switch. That's there. And so now it makes it very easy to remember and use the syntax. So that's snippets. And for those of you, again, I saw a number of people raised your hand who've used PowerShell. I guarantee you're going to wish you had this when you were learning PowerShell, okay? So here's the gotcha. Imagine I've got the script get ID. Ooh, I guess that was for dramatic effect. Don't know what that was. Did you trip on something?
I didn't trip on anything.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pass in a process name. We're going to do get process.
We're back.
Plug something in. We're going to get this process, and we're going to assign it to $X, and then we're going to ask for the ID. Right? What could go wrong with that? Right? Looks perfect. So we'll go ahead and we'll say, what did I do there? Blah, 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 blah. What? Oh. Thank you. I missed this. Okay. So then what I'm going to do is I'm going to say get ID and give the name LSASS. And it gives me the ID. Yay! That's wonderful. Perfect. Right? Okay. But what happens if I pass in star? Well, get process minus name star is going to return a set of things, and that set doesn't have an ID, and so it's going to have an error. So the way you had to do this in the past was you always had to write this, $&, you always had to cast it to an ID, or sorry, to an array, and then get the first element. And so we'll do that, and you'll see here that works, and now if I say star, that works as well. Okay? But that was in the past. Now, what we do is we've eliminated the seam between singletons and collections. So concretely, I can go get rid of that. I can get ID for a single machine, or when I get it for a lot of machines, it provides me, it's an array operator. It returns the ID of the collection. Now, but wait, it's even better than that. So now I'll say $X equals get process LSASS. And just to make sure that this is, so you're clear, get type. Okay, this is a process object. It is not a collection. Okay, it is not a collection. But I can treat it as a collection of one. Okay, so again, we've fully eliminated this scene. So lots and lots of improvements to PowerShell. You're going to like it a lot. I think that was it. Yeah, perfect.
Great. And so as we've said, there are drill down sessions in each of these areas. Tomorrow, I know it's the last session of the day tomorrow, but tomorrow at 5 o'clock, Hemant and Travis will be talking about the advanced automation using PowerShell 3.0. Very exciting session. I encourage you all to attend if you want to see the next level and see some of the great things that we've added in to PowerShell 3.0. So with that, I'm going to hand to you, Jeffrey.
All right. Okay, so now we're going to talk about the multi-machine management experience, right? So you've been hearing about PowerShell, standards-based management. Who cares about all that? Lots of people just want to see the GUI. Have you abandoned the GUI? Good Lord, no. I mean, the GUIs and GUI management and simplifying management is one of the core things Microsoft has made built its success on. So we're definitely not walking away from the GUIs, and you will see that. So, but what we've done is in the past, our GUIs were very separated from our automation story. That is what has changed. We now layer our admin GUIs on top of our automation story. So it's no longer an either or, it's an and story. Okay? So in this release, we really focused in on design, right? And when you see the new server manager, I mean, it's just it's just gorgeous, right? And why? We focused in on design. We wanted to make it glanceable, right? We wanted to make it relevant so that you look and immediately you know whether or not you have to pay any attention to things or whether everything's fine, or if there's something that requires your attention, where to spend your time and attention. We wanted to make it relevant, showing you the information that was pertinent to you and not just a sea of information. And we wanted to make it actionable, right? When you see something, be able to act and do the appropriate thing right there in context as opposed to navigating around or using your mouse to go back and forth. When you have an action, you do it right there. Now, remoting is the default, right? We're in this version of the operating system, we're changing. Okay, we're changing. In this version of the operating system, the preferred configuration is server core. Okay? And the way you manage server core is you take our management and you do remote management, you install it on a client, you have a rich graphical user interface, but you remotely manage the servers. Okay? So you can do that with our RSAT tool, remote server administration tool, and we have a web access, the ability to manage things remotely via PowerShell web access. So remote management is part of the key part here. And of course, consistency. As you know, just consistency drives down the cost. Consistency between the command line and the GUI so that there's no longer a, that thing I did in the GUI, that's exactly what I want to do. I just want to do it to 10 machines. How do I do that? We want to solve that problem. But between the workloads, we want to make the different workloads, server, other things, you know, the same, and across configurations, whether it's server core, full server, server with a GUI, et cetera. Okay, so in order to do this, you need a solution that manages multiple technologies that span servers. And that was our mission for Server Manager. Now, we want to be able to do aggregation and drill down. Okay, so when you have multi-machine management, you know, there's a lot of things to look at. So what do you want to do? You want to see summaries and dashboards, but then you want to be able to drill down and to get into the specifics. And the interesting thing about this is you want to pivot it two ways. Sometimes you want to see aggregations and drill downs by technology. Hey, I'm focusing in on file server. I just want to see file server specifics, and then I want to drill down into the file server. Or, hey, I'm looking at a particular server, so show me everything about that server and show me all the details of that server. Okay, so both pivots are important. And with that.
Awesome. Thanks, Jeffrey. Okay, so I'm going to walk you through the new Server Manager experience in Windows Server.
The glorious experience in
Windows Server 2012.
I just love it.
And I'm going to try and take a thing. You might have seen this in some of the previous sessions. We're going to try and dive just a little bit deeper. And then we have another session on Thursday that is really the deep down kind of guts of what's in you can do in Server Manager in this release that I'd encourage you to attend if this is a tool that you think that you'll be using on a common basis. So as Jeffrey said, we really looked in this release at how we redesigned the user experience. But we wanted to provide an experience that was fresh. It looked like it was sort of new and on the leading edge and embraced a lot of the Metro style principles that you'll see coming out across the various other product lines within Microsoft. But we also wanted it to be familiar. We wanted it to be something that was approachable, that was grounded in concepts that we really see IT pros using. And so you'll see the dashboard here, a lot of the principles that we applied. We've taken a lot of pride in craftsmanship. We've really paid attention to the design and the details and the finish and the polish around it. But we've also made sure that the right functionality is there and that you can do what you need to within the tool. So as Jeffrey said, there were three main pivots that we thought about when we were doing the design. First, we wanted it to be glanceable. So here we have the dashboard. It really should direct your attention to the things that you need to take action on, to provide you with that snapshot or summary of what's happening in your environment. So here you can see I have a little welcome tile that I probably would have hidden on the first when I first used this after I went through the initial setup. But we have tiles that are exposed that are grouped based upon the roles that I have in my environment. Here you can see that I have 7 servers total in my environment. I have 6 different roles, and they are installed across those various servers. So I'm really providing you with that information at a glance that you need to know. I have some kind of coloring that's actually drawing my attention into these areas. I'm actually going to start up here. I have a little notification. You can see if I click on that, it gives me a couple notifications. My automatic refresh has actually failed. I'm going to go in and look at the task details on that because I think it's interesting. So if I look at that task refresh details, my server WS08R2 demo 1 is actually the performance counters. Performance counters failed on that. So why is this really interesting? This is the number one question that I've gotten at the booth. Yes, we support down-level servers in the new server manager interface. So you can install the Windows Management Framework on those down-level machines, and we can detect them and we can pull information in. We can't pull all of the information. So in this case, we can't pull the performance counter information. What we pull in events and services, and so you can have one central view across your environment. It includes both Windows Server 2008 and 2008 R2 machines. So I'm gonna go back. I'm gonna kind of clear that because I've looked at that. I have some post-deployment configuration tasks. I'll do at a later date. But here you can see I've got a number of alerts that are showing up. Let me drill into the BPA results. I have an issue that I have the server isn't bound to at least one IP address. I can go deal with that issue. I can choose to ignore it or exclude that result if it's something in my environment that I know isn't an issue. And we've really tried to make this experience customizable for you, both in terms of what you show, but also the level of information. So here, if I look within the security levels, by default, I'm just showing the errors because I think that that's what you really want to draw your attention to. But if I'm troubleshooting a problem or there's something going on in my environment, I may actually want to dial that up and get both the informational errors as well as the warning errors so that I can have that in my dashboard. So you can do this on a role-by-role basis. So you can customize your environment. If there's one role that you particularly want to see more information on and another role that you want to see less, that's all customizable. I'm going to click OK. And I'm going to go back to my dashboard. Again, we've talked about this being multi-machine. So here I have a problem. I have 3 services in print that I have an issue with. And I can see across my 3 machines that the print spooler is actually down. We want the information here to be directly actionable. So I shouldn't have to go somewhere else in the console and actually figure out how to start these services. Look it, I can just right-click, start those services, and it's going to go out across those 3 machines, take care of restarting those services. I see they're actually started now, and I can go on with my day. Back to the customization. Here, if I look at the events, I can see the critical events across the servers. This event ID 41 seems to be showing up in a lot of places. I have somebody on my team who's looked into that. I know it's not an issue. And so I can do things like just say minus 41 and say, I don't want to look at event ID 41 in this. So you can clean this up again and tune it to your environment. So you're really seeing the information that's important to you and that you want to take action on from that main dashboard. Last thing I'll show you around kind of the customization is that you can actually go in and create your own server group. So let's say I have, my Boston servers, and I know that server 4 and server 2 are in Boston. I can add that in, click OK. And you'll see that automatically a new tile comes up that actually just contains the information from those 2 servers. So again, fully customizable in your environment. In the session on Thursday, we're going to go in and show you all the kind of nitty-gritty details and ways that you can actually customize the environment. If I drill down, you'll see that there's some really interesting functionality. So here I had my DHCP. It's installed on 2 servers. I can double-click and go directly into a view that shows those 2 servers I have in DHCP. I can multi-select them. You'll see the events and the information below get scoped to the various services, BPAs that are running on them, etc. So this is providing that drill down by role. I can also provide the drill down by servers. So here, that was my refresh error from before, so I'm going to clear that. You can see that I have my Windows Server 2008 machine, R2, as well as the various different Windows Server 2012 machines. I'm going to multi-select this. Click down. And one of the things that's really interesting is that we're using common controls across the entire surface of Server Manager, which means you have rich functionality in these controls available to you across the surface of the console. So let's just see within here in roles and features. Let's say I know I don't want the GUI installed on all my machines. So I'm going to go in and just basically sort and filter that list based upon the word graphical to see which machines are actually running the GUI.
I love that.
I can do things like I can actually save that query. I'm not going to do that because I actually already have one, but if I drop down this list, I can have pre-canned queries in these lists for things that you commonly search and filter around and that you want to switch between. I can do additional things like in the my tile. Just one second, I'm clicking in the wrong place.
You can do almost anything.
You can do almost anything. I can group by, so I can group by severity. I can filter and sort. So rich functionality available all to me within the tool, so that you can get access to that information. Yeah. We think that's really important from a troubleshooting scenario when you go in and you want to find information that you have in your environment. So this really provides you with kind of that high-level overview, dashboard, where do I want to go first? But we know that people, you typically come into a console like this with two intentions. The first intention is I have a specific task that I want to perform. And we've partnered with a set of the workload teams within Server, the Windows the remote desktop services, the file services, and the IP address management.
They're building
something backstage. Yeah. And
it's
so
be a grand reveal at the end. We've got this huge motif being built.
So let's drill into one of those specific experiences. So I'm going to go into the file and storage services.
Hey guys. Okay, thank you.
Let's go into the file and storage manager. So one of the things that the storage team has done in this release is to really make a consistent experience, whether or not you have local storage attached to your server or you have network attached storage, and to provide an easy way to scale that, you know, to take it as you attach that storage and then extend it into your environment. So I'm going to go through and show you what we think a very targeted task would be. I'm in here. I want to actually add a pool, a storage pool, and then assign it a virtual disk and expose it into the environment. So I'm going to go through. I found my storage pools. I have a sort of unused space on my Demo 3 server. I'm going to create a new storage pool, go through. And this is really a guided experience that takes me through what it takes to create a storage pool. You can see that what is happening is that it's dynamic. The information that's exposed in the wizard is based upon what the capabilities of the server support. So here I'm going to go through. I'm going to actually take three of those disks, put them into the storage pool, and click Create. It's going to go off and create that. Well, I've created a storage pool, but it really isn't useful to me unless I actually create a virtual disk. So at the end of the wizard, it's going to actually prompt me, well, do you want to go create a virtual disk when this wizard closes? So I'm going to select that, and it links me into the next task. So we're really trying to provide these guided experiences so that you can accomplish the scenario that you want end-to-end within the context of Server Manager. So I'm going to go in. I have that test pool again. I'm going to assign it a virtual test virtual drive, a name. Tells me whether I want simple, mirror, or parity in my configuration. Again, all of these things are coming from the storage subsystem, so it only exposes the options that I have related to the configuration. I can do thin or fixed provisioning. Thin provisioning is, I think, one of the cool features in the new release. It actually allows me to provision the disk greater than the physical disk that I have, so that if I have an application that kind of likes to trick you and say, oh, I need, like, you know, a huge amount of space, but they're really, I never use it. You can actually provision, here I only have 297 gigabytes, but I can provision the drive to be much bigger than that, and it will actually only use the actual physical space that is free. I click confirmation, I click create, and I keep going in there, and I could link me through. Again, you'll see at the end of this that, hey, I've created the virtual disk, now I need to create a volume, and it'll walk me through that process. So we really think we put a lot of investment into that whole guided experience. Now the other form of that experience is more of the, I'm gonna cancel out of this, is more of that ad hoc. So I know, Jeffrey, you were having a problem, we were talking about it yesterday,
right,
where you were having a problem saving some file
expense
to
reports.
Your expense reports.
Yep.
Okay, well that's a server I don't normally manage, so I'm gonna go in, I'm gonna add servers. I know the file server is server 5, so I'm gonna pick that in, click that. And it's going to go out, it's going to discover that server, bring it in, and that server actually has the file share set up on it. So you'll see that now I have some additional options. So the console is fully customizable to what the capabilities are of the servers that you're targeting. So here I go into the shares. Okay, it was an expense report problem.
Yep.
So this is kind of simulating what I might do from a troubleshooting standpoint. So I'm going to... All right, expense reports. Okay, there's the file. There's the share you were trying to copy to. And we've provided a view kind of all in one of the various information. So here there's quota. There's how big is the file that you're
it's
using?
It's pretty small.
So, okay.
Like 20K.
14 and a half. And that's not a quota issue. So let's go in. Let's take a look at the properties. I'm going to go in and look at permissions. Oh, there. You only have read access. That's the problem. So right from here, from this centralized view, I can see all the pivots on the different information. I can get access to what I need. Really helps me walk through and troubleshoot scenarios that I have in my environment. So I'm going to cancel out of this because we found the problem. I'll give you access later.
Thanks.
And so my last thing that I wanted to show was PowerShell Web Access.
Ooh, ooh.
And so I think you might have seen this in a couple of presentations earlier. Really what this provides me the ability to do, I'm just going to type in my...
Do you need two E's on coffee?
I probably do. I'll go back just a sec. All right, so what this allows me to do... is to essentially, we have the PowerShell Web Access installed on a machine. It's the gateway machine. I connect to that machine. It's running PowerShell Web Access IIS. And then it allows me to create a session to any server that I have in my environment. So it's essentially just that gateway that then allows me to connect, open a remote PowerShell session on that remote server from within any browser that supports JavaScript cookies, and that's all you need. So within it, I have the ability to do everything like I would within a normal PowerShell window. It supports things like tab completion, right? I don't think I have that installed on that machine, so it might error out. But really, this really provides that breadth or reach of access. Now, this is really cool. But, you know, I just showed you a basic scenario where I have the administrator who logs onto that machine. One of the other capabilities that we've put into the new release is this ability to build out delegated administration. So I have my new junior admin that's joined my company. I've given you a demotion there, Jeffrey.
Thanks.
And I'm going to actually...
Knew it was coming.
I'm going to try and log on with Jeffrey to that same. Let me make sure that I have
somehow
that same machine.
Password. That's interesting.
And you'll see that I haven't actually granted Jeffrey access, so it won't authenticate. He can't log on. But there's some other interesting capabilities.
That's your first hint that your career is going down the pipe. Your badge no longer opens the door, and you.
But there are some other optional connection settings. So we support things like if I want to authenticate to the gateway using one set of credentials, but I need a secondary set of credentials to actually authenticate to the end machine, we support that. We support different authentication types, and we support different configurations. So I've actually created an endpoint on the server demo one machine called Junior Admin, and I've restricted the permissions that that endpoint has. So here you can see Jeffrey can log into this, but if he tries to do, you know, certain things like get command, he's not actually able to do that, right? I've actually limited it to he can only do get service. He can do that job fine. But really what you can do in this scenario is restrict what commands you want end users to be able to do on a specific machine. And then in this case, actually, Jeffrey doesn't even have admin privileges to that machine. So I've actually allowed him to run as when he connects the administrator account. So I don't have to give more permissions to that end user than I want. So very, very powerful in your environment. It's available. I've demoed it in PowerShell Web Access, but you can set it up using regular PowerShell as well. And Travis is actually going to demo in that advanced automation session tomorrow.
Yep.
All the kind of glory behind this of how you can go through and configure that.
Awesome stuff.
Cool.
Yeah, so I think without a doubt, we're certainly not under-investing in the GUIs, right? We're layering these rich experiences on top of our automation layer. And in fact, because we're able to leverage our automation layer, a whole bunch of that GUI stuff is easier to do, and so we can focus more on design and lessen the mechanics of actually getting things done. So it's pretty exciting. So here's where you can go learn more. We've got the session that Wally's going to give on Thursday. Okay, so here's the thing. IT pros manage both clients and servers, okay? So what that means is, you know, we have exactly the same, you know, we've got a server desktop that's the same on server, sorry, a desktop that's the same on server and on client, okay? So we share that Metro update with the client. Now, what we've done is we've optimized that for admins. We'll show you what that is. But really, server manager is the experience to manage the admin, to manage servers. And in particular, server manager running on clients and doing remote management is the way to do that. And then you'll see we've extended server manager to be able to launch a bunch of the admin tools. So a number of you are concerned that the start menu went away. Well, we've added something like that for you in Server Manager. Okay, and then Server Manager is the same whether it's local or remote. And we have new deployment options here. Again, I mentioned this earlier, the preferred and default configuration of server is now Server Core. We provide what's called Server with a GUI as an option for backward compatibility. And there's this new option, which is called Minimal Server Shell, Minimal Server Interface. And what that is it's the full server with a GUI, where you take away Internet Explorer and the Metro shell, and what you have is an environment where you can run graphical user interfaces, you can run MMC, you can run your management tools, you can run Server Manager, but you have to start them from the command line. And what this does is it gives you many of the benefits of Server Core: reduced footprint, lower servicing footprint, fewer patches, but for those people who aren't able to make the full transition to Server Core. And unlike in the past, now you can switch between these modes. In the past, you chose Server Core or you chose full server, and that was it. Your cast was die. And now what you can do is start off with full server, configure things, and then bring it down to Server Core to run it. And if you have an issue that you want to bring in the GUI tools, you bring it back to full server, do whatever you want to do, and can bring it back down to full server. So lots of flexibility there.
So let's show you a little bit of what this looks like. I put it to the wrong. Okay, so I'm back within Server Manager. I'm on Server Demo 1, and I'm actually going to create a remote desktop session to that machine. As I mentioned, I have Server Manager running on a client machine. It's actually not running on the server machine. I can do everything from the client that I could do from the server. So when I connect in here, you're going to see that this is a server running the full GUI. And it has that desktop experience that's very consistent with the Windows 8 client. But we've done some things with this. We'll default boot you into the desktop versus booting you into the start screen. And we'll automatically launch Server Manager because we think that that's the main point where you're going to use as an entry point into your tools and what you need to do.
Oh, so previously that was you were running that on the client?
I was running that on the client. And the remote server admin tools, this is the first release where we've actually simultaneously shipped the RSAT package along with both the beta as well as the RC, so you can go out and you can, we haven't gotten rid of that fabulous shutdown dialogue. You'll see. But here you can see I've come in and I am auto-booted into the desktop, and I have Server Manager launched by default. So this is kind of has the Metro-style experience. I can click in the lower right-hand corner to get the start screen. We've customized some of the options that are available on the right-hand side to make them more server-specific. For those of you who haven't interacted with this, just a couple of things. If I click on Settings, this is where I can find the power, the shutdown option. So I click on power and I can disconnect, shutdown, restart the machine. If I actually go into the start menu, you can see if I click on the icon for the username, that's where you can lock or sign out of the machine. And then on the start menu, you'll see we've pinned a default set of things, again, that we think are the top things that an IT pro would do on the server machine itself to the start screen so that you can easily access them, including the administrative tools. You can actually type in the start screen and find the administrative tools. So here you can do that. One of the things I love is if I actually backspace out of that, it gives me all of the applications that exist in my environment. Okay, so I'm going to go back to the desktop. You can see within Server Manager, we've added this tools menu, and that tools menu actually contains all of the tools that you would have found in the administrative folder. And there's actually a really neat trick with this. You can actually customize that tool menu, and Ollie's going to show you how to do that in the session on Thursday, the drill down into Server Manager. But what I wanted to show you, the last thing I want to show you, is that I can go in and I can remove the server GUI. So I go in, I select my server, I can go into features, and you'll see if I scroll down, there's a set of user interfaces and infrastructure, and I can go in, I can remove the graphical management tools and the graphical shell. So if I remove the server graphical shell, it'll take me down to that min server, but still keep all of my tools, MMC tools, server manager, et cetera, to run. If I remove both of them, it'll take me all the way down to server core. In the interest of time, I'm not gonna show that, but I'm gonna actually go over and just quickly connect into a Min shell machine. Ooh. So as you see, I'm going to connect into this, and it'll actually auto-launch Server Manager for me, and we'll be able to see that all of my tools are available, but I don't have the IE, or I don't have that Metro-style shell.
You know, I just realized we didn't explain why Server Core is so important. Server Core is so important and why it's our preferred solution, because that has a dramatically reduced security footprint, resource footprint, and serviceability footprint. There are people who had Server Core had, what was the number? It was like 50 to 70% fewer critical patches than a server with a GUI. So I know patching's not your favorite thing. That's what Server Core is all about. And we want to maximize the GUI. Look, servers are expensive resources. 100% of those resources should be spent doing a job of a server, not doing up GUIs.
So here you can see I've come in, I've booted up, Server Manager's been launched by default. If I minimize that, I actually don't have anything behind, so no kind of shell, no IE, but I can do things like if I want to launch Computer Manager, MMC runs in this environment, I have access to the full set of my tools. So if you're not willing to kind of dive right into the deep end with Server Core, this is a great way to get yourself on the path to move towards and reduce the surface area of what you have installed on your servers.
Great, so you can learn more about this. Andrew Mason's going to give you all the details in the Deploying Windows Server 2012 from Bare Metal, Server Core, Minimal Server Interface, and more. Andrew's provided some great leadership on this for the company, so he's the guy to deliver this talk. Right, so wrapping up here, Windows Server, right? In the past, we were great OS for a server, but now there's this dramatic transformation with Windows Server 2012. We want to be a great OS for lots of servers, the devices that connect those, whether they're physical or virtual, whether they're on-premises or off. And the way we do this, we had to change the way we did things, right? We had to embrace standards-based management like we never did before. Allows us to manage all the non-standard things. Effectively, what we're doing is we're using standards-based management to produce the data center equivalent of the hardware abstraction layer, the HAL. Okay, so that's very important stuff. We have robust automation. Once you have lots of machines, you want to be able to automate them so you don't have to mouse click all your life away. We want to make it simple and easy to automate, increase the number of servers per admin through automation, and the ability to deal with the messy world and drive up consistency and quality. And then, of course, we want to have a rich multi-machine management experience. We have a fantastic new server manager to deal with this complex world. It's optimized for remote management, and we've got a rich ISC to do the PowerShell remoting and web access. So I think here's a bunch of related content, breakout sessions, hands-on labs, and we're down here at the booth. We love talking to customers, so please come do that. And I think that's that.
Yeah.
So thank you very much for your time. We greatly appreciate it. And two call to actions. One, fill out the evaluations. They really do matter. We do really read all that stuff. And number two, download the RC of Windows Server and kick the tires. It's an awesome release, and it's a fun release. You're going to enjoy it. So thank you.